I guess you could call it a back-to-basics approach. A Toronto support program is working with addicts who have repeated relapses into a life obsessed with alcohol, drugs, food, and sex. All Addictions Anonymous says its program concentrates solely on the power of the original 12-step program with nothing diluted. They don't have sobriety birthdays, celebrating medallions, or poetry reading at these meetings. The approach is much different. It relies on a recovered addict working intensely with a fellow addict on the 12 steps. There are many addiction fellowships out there, like, of course, AA, Gambling Anonymous, Overeaters Anonymous, and others that use the 12-step program as well. Each one has helped thousands of people, and everyone's recovery is quite different. Today on the program, we're going to be talking about the All Addictions Anonymous program, but we also want to know what kind of recovery approach has worked for you. Give our studio a call at 1-888-817-8995. That's 1-888-817-8995. Maybe you found something that, of course, one can never say one is completely done with any addiction, but perhaps you found a way of getting you through the day, what has worked for you, what hasn't worked in approaches in the past. 1-888-817-8995 is the number to call anywhere in Ontario. Scott, the founder of All Addictions Anonymous, joins us now from our Toronto studio. Of course, anonymity is at the core of all recovery fellowships, so we're only using Scott's first name. We're going to be doing the same for you when you call in at 1-888-817-8995. And Scott, welcome to the program.
Thanks, Alan.
What is All Addictions Anonymous?
Well, All Addictions Anonymous, I'm just reading this from our What Is AAA. All Addictions Anonymous, through our own experience, have found that drunk logs, telling war stories, discussing our personal problems or issues, celebrating medallions or sobriety birthdays, interpreting slogans, reading poetry, will not keep chronic relapse addicts of our type sober and clean.
Why?
What happens, our program is based on the original 12-step program, which is contained in the book, mm-hmm. Alcoholics Anonymous, which is distinct from the fellowship Alcoholics Anonymous.
Right.
And so in that book, it's a precise, clear-cut set of directions as to what you need to do in order to recover, in order to stay permanently recovered. And in that book, it tells us what we need to do. And in that book, 100 pages are describing the recovery program. And there's only a couple places in the entire book where they talk about meetings. One place is on page 17 where it says that the fellowship or the meetings are only one element in the powerful cement which binds us, and that the meetings on their own would never have held us together as we're now joined. And that was at a time when recovery rates were 75% plus. Mm-hmm. Recovery rates in all the fellowships are like below 10% of what I've heard. And so what we're doing is getting back to the basics, what's in that book, and permanent recovery is what we're after. And it says it in one place in that book, that strenuous work, one addict with another, is vital to permanent recovery.
Right. Now, Scott, before we continue with your program, what are you seeing happen in AA now? Like, when we're talking about this program being watered down with the meetings right now, what isn't working about AA? Why do you think that it's not what it could be?
Well, I got to say that I'm a little hesitant and cautious to answer that question. I will, because Alcoholics Anonymous, we don't want to trash any of the fellowships. What we've noticed is that there are certain type of alcoholics, certain types of addicts that are beyond human aid, that have actually lost the power of choice in staying sober, as it said on page 24. These are the people that first came to AA back in the 1940s. They were the down and out, absolutely hopeless addicts that were going to die, and they surrendered themselves to this program of absolute honesty, making all your amends and working one-on-one with other alcoholics because their life depended on it. What happened is the program was so successful that so many meetings grew up all over around the world, and people that weren't really alcoholics that could actually just stay sober on their own willpower started coming to AA. Mm. And then these people, and God bless them, they deserve to come. Like, everybody's welcome. But see, these people didn't have to work the actual transformational, life-changing program.
Right.
All they had to do was come to the meetings, talk about their problems, do a little group therapy, and they'd stay clean. And what happens is the real addict hears what they're doing and says, I'd rather do that than never tell a lie again. I'd rather do that than make all my amends and pay off all the debts on everyone I've screwed over for the rest of, for my whole life.
Mm-hmm. And with your program, how is that different? I mean, that same person heading into your intensive 12-step program, how is it approached?
Well, first of all, the big thing that's really different is if you go on to AllAddictionsAnonymous.com or you call our pager, we're not going to say, come to one of our meetings.
Mm-hmm.
That's every other fellowship says, here's where our meetings are. We realize chronic addicts, the meetings have very little to do with recovery. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to hook you up with somebody who's recovered from ideally the similar addiction that you suffer from, and they're going to sit down with you face to face and study this big book. You will meet them in a coffee shop or at their home, whatever works mutually for both of you, and you will study this book and you will read it to that person, and that person will make sure you understand every word. And when there's an instruction, the recovered addict will actually help you take that instruction so that you actually work the 100 pages. It does precisely what the book says to do. In fact, the big book says to show other alcoholics precisely how we have recovered is the main purpose of this book. We just substitute the word alcohol for any addiction. We're talking self-harm, someone that might slit their wrists, or it could be anorexia. We have women that are actually recovered from anorexia and bulimia. We've got people that are recovered carrying that message one-on-one. The process takes anywhere from actually 1 week to maybe 90 days, about 30-hour, 40-hour investment of the person's time. And by the end of that process, if they do exactly what the book says to do, they will be recovered.
I know it's tricky to ever try and set deadlines to things, but have you discovered that over the steps, is there a timeline that people can expect, or is it so different from person to person?
It is. Here's what I'll tell you is, in the early days, Bill Wilson, the founder, Dr. Bob, the co-founder of Alcoholics Anonymous, they worked the steps in less than 2 weeks. Less than two
weeks.
Is that
right? At the beginning of AA?
Absolutely. It's in the book. Some people say less than a week, so I'm just going to under-promise, over-deliver.
Okay,
less than
2 weeks.
And they were out working with other alcoholics and addicts immediately. In fact, Bill Wilson carried the message to Dr. Bob in 60 days.
So in the case of AAA, the All Addictions Anonymous, what kind of, you mentioned, for instance, women finding themselves recovered from anorexia. What kind of success stories have you seen? Or have you seen, I mean, it's always a challenge, right? No matter what kind of addiction it is that you're trying to recover from. Are there people that you found that even the strict AAA program doesn't work for?
You know what? This works for absolutely any addiction, whatever it is. And I want to get back to your question, though, that your question was, what is a timeline? The timeline depends upon the person's level of willingness. And we can have people go through these steps in 3 to 4 hours. We can have them go through in a week if they're that willing and desperate to do what the book says to do. But most people aren't totally at that place of desperation when they come to us. So we work the program as fast as they're willing to do it. We don't push them any faster than they can go, but we're not going to slow them down if they're desperate and they want to move on with the program. It says it takes 12 steps to recover. It takes 12 steps for that obsession, for whatever your addiction is, to actually be removed. So why would you want to go to the 12? Why would you want to go through them slow? You mm-hmm. can relapse at any point in time before you hit step 12. Why would you do it slow? It makes no sense.
We mentioned that you're in Toronto. How many chapters of AAA are there?
Well, we started in Toronto, and we have a couple meetings here, and we're in the Toronto detoxes. But we've got people. You know, our website is really, we've got a lot of people all over the world connecting with us, you know, it's from Sweden, Australia, different places, Mexico, all over the world that stand for this same solution and they're giving us their contact information so that we can hook them up with other people over the world. Because remember, with AAA, with All Addictions Anonymous, we are not about the meetings. We are members of all the different fellowships. I myself am a recovered crack cocaine addict, sex addict, alcoholic, marijuana addict. I used to smoke 3 packs of cigarettes a day, 28 coffees a day. I've recovered of so many addictions, and it was one addiction at a time.
Hmm. We're going to hear from listeners now about what has worked and what hasn't worked for them in recovery programs. We're joined by Scott, who's the founder of All Addictions Anonymous. He's in Toronto. Number to call, 1-888-817-8995. Joanne is on the line from Fort Frances. Hi, Joanne.
Hi there.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Have you discovered programs that worked for you?
I've been an Al-Anon member, which is sort of a sister branch or whatever you want to call it, of AA. And that is based on a 12-step approach as well. And I think the key for me has been working those 12 steps. Absolutely. You know, the meetings are great because you do connect with people who are in the program. But we really, really do focus on the 12 steps, on personal commitment to working those 12 steps, because that's the key.
Can you explain? You know, can you explain what about the 12 steps? What point you felt a turning point happening? I don't know if that's an accurate way of describing it.
Well, my history is that, you know, probably I'm 41 years old. Probably about 20 years ago, I first walked through the doors of Al-Anon. I went for 3 or 4 meetings, and my commitment wasn't there. Didn't do anything for me. Mm-hmm. That was within me. That wasn't, you know, the program failing. I wasn't ready for it. Then about 7, 8 years ago, I went again. I was at a point where I was desperate for changes in my life. So at that point, I was able to commit myself. It's a process of looking at yourself. I cannot change the world, but I can change me.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, at that point, 0 to 12 in no time at all. You know, and the process of the program is, too, you don't quit. You don't do the 12 steps once and you're done. It's an ongoing thing.
Right. You're always doing the 12 steps.
You are always doing the 12 steps. It has to become part of your life, you know. I have to look at pretty much everything I do, everywhere I go, in context of what am I doing, what should I be doing, how does this affect the whole big picture. Because if I don't commit to that, I can be back there in a heartbeat, back to where I was before. I don't want to live like that anymore.
Scott, you heard Joanne say there that idea that she had to be ready for it, that she had to be accepting of it. Do you hear that from members where they say, you know what, I'm just not ready for this 12-step?
Absolutely, and I agree with everything that Joanne said, and particularly about the part about, you know, you got to keep doing them. And what a better way to keep doing them than to be teaching them to another. I mean, that's a universal truth. That which you teach becomes even greater in your own knowledge and your experience. So every time I'm sitting through that big book of Alcoholics Anonymous, teaching it to someone else, I become more socially committed and accountable to work in the program more rigorously myself.
Michelle's on the line from Clinton. Hi, Michelle.
Hi there.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Have you found recovery programs that work?
Well, my dad was a part of AA for many years. He started it in 1972 when he hit bottom, mm-hmm. and lost his family and lost his job. And basically, the doctor said that he only had a short time to live. And he turned to Alcoholics Anonymous, and he went through the 12 steps, Scott said, very quickly. But he continued to go to AA every single day of his life. Even when he went on holiday, he would find the local chapter and go to it. And that was, he basically said that Alcoholics Anonymous has saved his life.
How long did that continue? And you said it was his whole life.
Pardon me?
Is your dad still alive?
He actually died in November.
Okay, so how
but not of alcohol, he died of cancer.
How many years are we talking going to AA every day?
30 years.
30 years.
Yeah, just over 30. He started in 1972, and he went every single day of his life unless he was sick. And he was a sponsor for 20 years, and that is someone that goes through the 12 steps with a newcomer and, you know, mm-hmm. is a friend and a guide to that person.
It's interesting.
He was doing that for 20 years.
It's interesting, Scott and Michelle, because I remember a friend of mine saying at one point while going through the program that they were worried that they were never going to feel free, and they understood they'd never be cured, but they would still like at some point in their life to be able to say, I don't need to go in every day anymore, I don't need to go every week anymore. And they were worried that, in a way, that the addiction almost became... I'm trying to phrase this the right way, but the addiction almost became going to the group.
Absolutely.
Do you hear that from people?
Yeah, I totally agree with you. That person that went to the AA meetings every day for 20 years, it sounds to me like they went for what the purpose was, which it says that we meet frequently so that newcomers can find the fellowship that they seek. In other words, we go to meetings to help others. But imagine if you're a bulimic or you've got a unique addiction like web internet or porn addiction. I mean, there aren't meetings. You can't guarantee all over the world that those meetings exist, but you can help another alcoholic. You can help another addict. You can work the steps and carry that message. The meetings are not the answer.
So sometimes is it, when you're talking about these pairing people up, sometimes is it, for instance, somebody who's a sex addict helping someone who's an alcoholic, or is it always the same addiction that you're paired up with?
Ideally, we pair up with the same addiction, but myself, I've experienced taking people through on absolutely any addiction, and it works even if I don't have the addiction myself.
Okay.
In fact, I didn't even know I had sugar addiction until someone came to me for help and said, I need help. And we sat down in the big book and we went through the doctor's opinion. I discovered his addiction was sugar. And then when I realized that, I realized I couldn't be eating sugar. That would be, you know,
It was in your system as well.
Yeah. And I recovered from, I haven't had sugar since I met that guy 4 or 5 months ago because of him.
Wow. Dave's on the line from London. Hi, Dave. Hello, Dave. Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
There you are. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thanks for taking my call. Great topic, guys. My father is a recovered alcoholic and has just received his 33 or 34th year medallion a couple of months ago.
Mm.
And I myself, I've been to more meetings than many alcoholics have. I went with him every Friday night when I was a kid for years. And I feel that when he was presented with his medallion for the time served, he cherishes that medallion. It's in his pocket. He rubs it daily, and that's a reminder of his life back. And I think sometimes when people want to view a successful program and dissect it, take it apart, and say that certain things aren't useful in it, you're really dealing with each individual person. Now, as I say, I personally have had problems with addiction in the past. Now, I've defeated every addiction except nicotine, only based on my personal inner growth.
Right.
And I feel the only thing that your guest's program and the Alcoholics Anonymous program and NA and CA and all these wonderful programs forget is to teach these people how to live again.
Hmm.
Because you take the addiction away from them, and your friend with you today, you take the addiction away, but if you don't teach that person psychologically how to be a real person again, then you end up like my father going from alcoholism to workaholism to where, whatever you want to refocus the ism is where that person will go.
And when you talk about those skills, Dave, like what sorts of things are you talking about?
With respect to mine?
Well, no, I'm asking if you're saying that it has to be more than just taking away the addiction. They have to be giving something to allow them to have lives afterwards. Things like what?
Sorry, yeah. I guess I mean more in respect to the reason I believe the meetings are successful is again, the word fellowship. The fellowship is the group, is the friendship, is you're not alone. Whereas is your guests' comments seem to make me feel as though the person's going to feel very alone.
Hmm. Scott, any thoughts?
Well, that's very good comments, and I want to get back to the first thing you addressed, which was that, you know, we need to teach these people how to live after the addiction has been removed. What you said goes exactly with what's in this big book. In the doctor's opinion, the chapter before the chapter one, Dr. Silkworth, who dedicated his life to helping alcoholics and addicts, says, just what you said, that they will relapse, quote, over and over, and unless this addict can experience an entire psychic change, there is very little hope of his recovery. See, the meetings do not create or give you an entire psychic change. but they do support you. The meetings are valuable. We all go to meetings. I'm glad you pointed that out, because that was missing in what I've been sharing with you, is we belong to other fellowships, and we go to those meetings so that we can be helpful and take people through the steps. But we're really clear that what is going to help, what is going to cause us to actually be free, where we're no longer restless, irritable, and discontented when we're free from our addiction, is actually working the steps and teaching others the steps.
All right. We're going to move on here to Jessica, who's out on the 401. Hi, Jessica.
Hi, how are you?
Good. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Have you found programs that work for you?
Yeah, I've been part of 12-step programs for 16 years, and I'm really glad that Scott is doing what he's doing, because certainly for chronic relapsers, it's very important that they get to the core of the program, which is the steps. However, I feel like listeners may also be getting the impression that that work isn't getting done in the mainstream program, and it is. There are people... Sorry, my navigation system is speaking to me.
That's okay. Sometimes the cars like to get in on the phone, and I understand. Yeah.
There are people all over the world working one-on-one with other addicts within the context of meetings and fellowship. And, in fact, I think the meetings and fellowship enable that contact. Sometimes an addict needs to hang out in meetings for a little while to develop a level of trust so that they're willing to work with another person. And
as opposed to just being set up.
What he's describing is the cake of the program, and meetings are definitely the icing. But the cake is not missing these days. It's there, and when meetings don't espouse the 12 steps and the 12 traditions, they tend to fall apart and die.
Right.
Yeah.
But you're saying that the cake is still going on at these
meetings. Correct. Okay. The program wouldn't exist if the cake weren't going on.
Right. Scott.
Yeah, again, I agree with you. And thanks for putting that in, because I'm nervous and I'm missing things. But what I do want to say is that there are meetings of AA, of all the different fellowships, where they're powerfully standing for the message all over the world, just like you said. But the problem is, because in accordance with the traditions, we're allowed to, any group can set up a meeting and operate it absolutely any way they want. As Joe and Charlie says, from AA, is some of these meetings have become, not all of them, but some of them have become group depression, group therapy meetings, where if you didn't read the preamble at the beginning of the meeting, you wouldn't know what kind of meeting you're in. So all Addictions Anonymous is doing is that we're taking a stand for the undiluted message that's in the big book, making it available for absolutely anyone, no matter what their addiction is, so that they can get a consistent message and consistent meetings. When you come to our meetings, it says here, I got to read it, the purpose of our meetings is to work the steps and to teach others how to work the steps. We connect suffering addicts to recovered addicts who will guide newcomers through a personalized one-on-one study of the original undiluted 12-step program described and outlined in the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous.
Hmm. Jessica, can I just ask before we move on to the next call, at what point did you feel things changing for yourself? People sometimes talk about a bolt from the blue, a moment one day, wow, everything's okay now. But is there a point where you thought, okay, wait a minute, I'm getting the 12 steps now?
To me?
Yes.
Well, my primary addiction was a food addiction. And with food, especially if you're not an anorexic, which is, you know, has a really high fatality rate, there's a little more room to mess around, to make mistakes, drugs and alcohol are very serious things that when people stop them, they need to stop them for good. And relapse is a very dangerous thing. It happens all the time. But I had more room, so I would say my recovery was slower, more nuanced, but definitely became more and more solid over time. And within that process, there were moments of massive spiritual awakenings where I just realized my life had completely turned around. But it wasn't a burning bush.
Okay.
And it was because I had the luxury to go to meetings. And I agree with Scott entirely. I have a problem myself with Overeaters Anonymous having developed its own literature, which I don't think is anything as close as powerful as AA's literature. And whenever I'm working with a newcomer in OA, I say to them, you have to get to the big book, you have to get to the steps of AA, because that's, for some odd reason, where the magic is. It's powerful, powerful literature.
Hmm.
And once it gets diluted by committee, which is how it happens,
right,
it sort of loses its spark.
Some of the oomph.
I love you.
Jessica, thanks for calling. Val's on the line from North Bay. Hi, Val.
Hi.
Welcome to the show.
Yes, I'd like to say 22 years ago I came off of Skid Row, Edmonton, and into the arms of Alcoholics Anonymous. And from then till now, I haven't taken a drink because I did the steps.
Congratulations.
No, there's no congratulations about it. That was my path, but I understand what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
That AA is practiced to this day, and I just came back from Kirkland Lake where we took a whole car full of sponsees up there. And the reason that the meetings are there is that after you've had the steps are kind of like a pathway to having a spiritual experience and a guide to living your life spiritually, that you go to the meetings and give that away and continue to do that and live the steps, not just work them. And you really cannot take them out of context of the whole book.
When you say live them, Val, what do you mean?
I lived them in every area of my life. I'm rigorously honest to the best of my ability, which is pretty good, maybe
right.
Too honest sometimes. And I don't talk about who I help or what I do. I don't feel the need to exert energy into diluting the program in any other way. I just work this program because I am an alcoholic. Now, I was dying when I came in here, and I am fearful of only having a one-on-one connection. It breeds self-righteousness.
You mean the one-on-one connection with another partner?
Like well, I'd like to have many opinions.
Right.
It was 100 people who started Alcoholics Anonymous, not one.
It's an interesting point, Scott, and I want to put that back. We're just about out of time here, but I want to put that back to you because I sometimes if you are relying on one person to be your main partner...
Absolutely.
Is there not fear of that person maybe not always knowing the right thing to do?
Absolutely, and that's precisely why... We sponsor through the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous. It's not our job to give people advice, to tell them what to do, how to live their life, or give our opinions on anything. All we do is we look at the Big Book, we start at the cover page where it says, to show other alcoholics precisely how we have recovered is the main purpose of this book, and we read that book to each other. And so that we can follow the instructions, because she's absolutely right. We have to follow a program that's been proven, and it's in the book, not in an individual.
Okay, Scott, if people are interested, what's the website?
Thank you. It's alladictionsanonymous.com. And if I could give our pager number two.
Sure.
It's 416-468-8603.
All right, we'll put that up on our website at cbc.ca/Ontario Today as well. Scott, thanks for being with us today.
Thank you so much.
Scott is the founder of the All Addictions Anonymous in Toronto. If you didn't get through on our program and you still want to comment about what kind of recovery program worked for you, give us a call, 1-888-59-